so much for coming to the Bangalore Life Sciences Cluster, also known as BLiSc Science Cafe. This is an initiative that we started about a year ago. It's going to be completed a year next month. And we've seen so far about 15 scientists from the cluster speak about the work that they do, what they're interested in, and the questions in science that fascinate them and befuddle them and all kinds of interesting things. So I have been chasing Gaiti for months, and she is an extremely elusive scientist. We might finally pin her down, and I'm so happy that she's been able to make it. She's one of my favorite scientists at NCBS. In no small part due to the fact that she's a great sense of humor, but she is also a very celebrated scientist. Gaiti is a fellow of the Indian Academy of Sciences, IAS, and she has recently been elected a fellow of the, Indian National Science Academy, INSA. And lots of other things. So you really should look her up. She has her own page on Wikipedia, so she's fancy like that. And so she's here to talk about one of her favorite topics, which is the fruit fly, which may seem completely uninteresting to you, but actually is opens a world of possibilities in terms of biology, and Gaiti can tell you about that. So please can you give her a really warm round of applause. And also to the fact that we've tried so hard to get her here, and she's here finally. So Gaiti, over to you. Thank you so much for being part of Science Cafe.
Thank you, Mayan. I'm looking forward to this. I will give you reasons for why. Just let me get this thing going. So when Mayan got me to agree to come for this, one of the reasons I thought it's a good idea to do this is because all my life I've been bugged by this question from all my family members and friends. Are you still working with that fruit fly? And this is now, I've been working on this since 1983. So you can imagine how many times this question has been asked and how often I've had to answer it. And I've always said, you know, Yeah, I do, and there's lots of interesting things. So finally I thought, okay, here's a time when I should maybe really, really try and explain why it is really interesting to work on the fruit fly. So have any of you ever wondered about it? Why people work on the fruit fly? Yes? What puzzles you about it?
Why particularly
does
why not together
with even closer to? Okay, so I'm going to try and answer that, okay?
Can you just repeat some of the questions?
Okay. So what he asked was that why Drosophila, why not any other fly? And I'm going to try and answer that as soon as possible, actually.
In fact, I think that might be the next answer.
So one of the thing is, okay, so this is actually true for all flies, okay? Fruit fly brains have about 100,000 neurons, yeah? And they have about 10 to the power 7 synapses. Compare that with what the human brain has, right? The human brain is much more complex, right? So looking at that, you might say that, you know, what on earth can we learn from the fruit fly brain, right? Because it's so small, what does it even do, right? So let me try and say that we who work in fruit flies, think it can do a lot. And I hope by the time you leave from this talk, you will be convinced of it. If you're not, you have to question me and you have to question my students who are here and try and get answers for it, okay? Okay, so why fruit fly? And just before I go to that, I'm going to just show you a nice picture of the fruit fly brain, because I really wanted to appreciate not only the fact that it's something that we work on, but that it is actually a really attractive looking object, okay? So what you have on the left, the two left sides are the eyes, okay? And then this is the central brain. And what you're seeing here are projections from neurons which are present in the organ that the fly uses to smell, okay? It's called the antennae, yeah? And this is true for all flies, okay? All flies have these. And For the fruit fly particularly, the sense of smell is really, really important. And again, I'll tell you that in a minute. So what this shows you is how the sense of smell is picked up from the antennae and how it's transmitted to a region of the brain from where all these neurons then sort of assimilate this information and transfer it into behavior. And this is something that's just happened very recently, actually. You can see it's in 2018. So this is the kind of work that's going on in the world, and people are actually trying to figure out exactly what connections are there in the fruit fly brain and how these impact function of this brain. Okay, so this is the person that I wanted to introduce you to. So your question now, I'm going to start answering that. This is Thomas Hunt Morgan. Okay, and this is in 1916. This photograph has been taken in 1916. So that is when people started working on the fruit fly, that long ago. Okay, and he's not the first person, there were other people who were working on it. The reason he's famous is because he actually decided that the fruit fly was actually an organism that one could grow in the lab easily. He figured out how to do it, and he's the first one who actually set up a lab for this, okay, an actual lab that could be used for doing fruit fly. And initially, the reason that he got into fruit flies was because of the fact that you can do genetics with it. Now, how many of you understand what is genetics? All of you do. That's good.
Don't believe them.
No?
Ask them.
Okay. Would anybody like to answer that? Who's the most comfortable answering what they think what genetics is? And my lab is forbidden from answering. Yeah. Does anybody want to answer that? You?
Everybody put their hands up and now nobody's answering.
No, they'll answer.
So basically, very biological meaning would be study of heredity.
Study of heredity. Very good. Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
Beyond science, I would just tell how you match your parents or anyone on this earth.
Sorry?
I would tell in basic how you match your parents or anyone on this earth.
You mean the molecular genetics part of it? Yeah. So that, yeah, I'll try and come to some of that. But I guess at that point when Thomas Hunt Morgan was working on this, it was basically the idea of heredity, yeah. And the idea was to try and understand how heredity is, you know, how traits are inherited from parents to the progeny. And fruit flies are wonderful because they have a very short life cycle of about 10 days. You can get lots of them, and you have an artificial medium on which you can grow them. So you can actually follow the traits very nicely in the lab. And so that was one of the reasons he chose it. The other reason I think that is quite important is that they have these wonderful chromosomes, okay? So these are chromosomes of a fruit fly, okay? And the reason you can see them so nicely is because the fruit fly larva, they go through these stages, okay? And in the larva, these chromosomes become what are called palatinized. That is, they get multiplied many times. The DNA gets multiplied. So this contains what in our cells would be just, you know, two copies of the chromosome. This has on each chromosome something like 1,000 copies, all added together. And there's a reason why they have it, because they want to make lots and lots of some particular kinds of things. But what this tells us then is that you have these chromosomes. You can actually see them. This is visible from the. So this is not something like an electron microscope or a, you know, very fancy confocal or anything like that. This is just a regular light microscope. You look down that, and you can actually see the chromosome in front of you. And what people have done over the years, in starting from somebody like Morgan. In fact, I think it was a little later. There's a person called Bridges who did this. He actually took these chromosomes and then tried to figure out exactly what their patterns are. So you can see there are these nice lines on them, right? These nice lines actually correspond to genes that are present on, not a single gene, but clusters of genes, okay? And what you can do in Drosophila is that you can actually find a trait, a hereditary trait, and then using the tricks of genetics that have developed over the years, you can actually say that this particular trait lies in this particular band here. And that is something that is actually not possible in all other organisms that easily. The other advantage of this is that there are very few of them, right? So you don't have to look at, like humans have 23 chromosomes. Here we only have 5 actually. I'm going to show them to you actually, because this is really something interesting.
sex determination is done, and then there are these two, these are two arms of the same one, these are two arms of the same one. So there are actually three big ones, and then there's a small one which you can't see, which is stuck in there. So just four chromosomes. And
probably that was one of the main reasons that we started working on this, because you can actually see the chromosomes and the numbers are very few, and you can actually map genes onto them. And so that's a big, big advantage as far as doing the genetics is concerned. And I think, and also the fact that you can grow them easily and all of that. So I hope your question is answered now. Yeah?
Great.
Okay, so I'm going to fast forward now to what is the kind of work that's been done with Drosophila over the time, okay? So it's really been used, all of these methods that were developed from early 20th century onwards have been used over the years to try and answer lots of interesting questions. And these are not only related to the brain, there are other things as well. So here is the first time that Drosophila won a Nobel Prize, okay? And this was in 1995. Okay, this is Edward Lewis on the left, that's Yanni Nussbaum-Wolhard, and that is Eric Michaus. Okay, and so down below you can see the stages of the fruit fly. You can see the egg, you can see the larva, and then it becomes a pupa, and then it becomes an adult. Yeah, down below there. And this, what do you think this looks like, a human being down there? What you're seeing, the flies? Would any of you consider that similar to a human being? Why not? Any answers?
No.
No? You don't think it's a... But if I tell you now that this organism is what has helped people understand how the developmental plan of a human being is designed, would you agree with me? Yes? No? You would?
No,
you wouldn't? Okay.
I would actually agree.
Yeah.
Because it has already been done.
Yeah.
I had a question, like frogs actually would resemble us more than an invertebrate.
Which one?
A frog.
Amphibians. A frog, yeah.
Because when we actually observe the amphibian embryos and when we compare them to humans,
So I'll talk a little bit about why. So I agree with you, but frogs have a backbone, yeah. They're vertebrates, and so there's a difference, right? So fruit flies don't have a backbone, right? Just like we have a spine, they don't have that at all. So they're what's called invertebrates, and invertebrates are actually even further removed from us in evolutionary history than a frog is. So it's not surprising that a frog is more similar than a fruit fly. But I think what is amazing is that using a fruit fly, you have actually been able to understand the human body plan. Yeah? And that is what this particular award was for. Okay? It was for understanding actually that the body plan that is there in the Drosophila is actually the same mechanisms and the same genes actually, the actual same molecules that are present in the fruit fly, those are conserved. And they function in similar ways in all organisms and all animals actually. Yeah. And I'm just going to show you a fun picture which is telling you how the two are similar. Okay. So the head is determined by a set of genes. Yeah. And that is actually the same set of genes that are required for vertebrates. So they were the same ones that are actually used in frogs as well. Yeah. And the same ones are used in Drosophila. And the only thing is that the way these genes are regulated and the way that they are diversified becomes more complex as you become more advanced in evolution. Yeah, but apart from that, the basic sets of genes are actually the same. Yeah.
So this is confirming the ontogenic recapitulation.
Sorry.
Ontogenic recapitulation.
Oh, that's right, yes, that idea, exactly, yes. It does recapitulate that, yeah.
Fox and other body plan, everything.
So they were discovered in Drosophila, those genes, yeah. Those Hox genes were actually discovered first in Drosophila, yeah. So that a lot of people who work on them now forget that, you know. So they'll give you some name and they say, you know, something, something. Like you say Hox, you know. And they don't realize that actually it stands for the homeobox genes, which were actually discovered in Drosophila many years ago. So nobody goes back and reads the literature and they think that, you know, you know, we always knew this. We didn't know this. And we wouldn't have known it if it wasn't for flies. So, yeah. Okay? Right, so that was the first one. Let's move to the second. Okay. Okay, this I just wanted to tell you. Okay, so just to say. So this was in 1995, that particular Nobel Prize. And that was actually before. So as you know, over the years, one of the things that has happened is that the methods for sequencing, you know, understanding what is actually present in your genes, how your genes are made up, the actual sequence that makes it up in terms of DNA, is actually being found out. Yeah? And in fact, the whole human genome has been sequenced and we now know every single gene that's present in humans and you know what its actual sequence is. But this was not when these people, when Yanni Nusslein and Mollard got the Nobel Prize, that was not the case. Okay? The full genome sequence was not known, so it's become much easier now to understand what the molecular basis of a trait is, right? What we were talking about. But this was not, in the times when Yanni Nusslein did, Rola did her work and Eric Wishaus did their work, they actually had to take what are called, you know, so the way they did it was that they mutagenized, that's the other thing you can do with Drosophila, you can mutagenize it, you can get mutants that look different so they don't have a head or they don't have a tail or whatever, right? And then you have to figure out where those mutations lie on these chromosomes. Yeah. So here are the chromosomes and that's why these chromosomes are so useful, you can figure that out. And they did all of this without knowing the sequence. Okay, so they actually did it at that stage. And I think that's the work that, and when they got those genes and people understood that, okay, this is actually, they have the genes that are there in Drosophila which drive this body plan, when people found that they are actually conserved in humans as well, or in vertebrates, I think that was the first, I think it became very clear that, you know, getting the sequence of the Drosophila genome would be really useful. And so, in fact, Drosophila was the first organism for which the full genome sequence of a complex organism, I should say. I'm not talking about bacteria or fungi or spongia or something like that. But the first one which was actually sequenced as a pre-run to doing the human genome sequence, okay? So this was done in 2000. And they found that there were approximately 16,000 genes. And what was interesting is, this is now subsequently, after the human genome has been sequenced, it's been found that nearly 60% of the genes that are found in humans are also found in Drosophila. Okay? So there's a lot of similarity in the kind of genes that are present between humans and flies. And this is not specific for Drosophila. You sequence anything else, it will also be the same. Okay? It's not that. It's just that this was the one that got done because of the history behind it, and so that's what happened. And importantly, what the other thing is that nearly 60% of human genetic diseases can be studied in flies. So many of the diseases for which we now know the genes in humans, the same genes are present in Drosophila. And you can think about it that using these genes now, because they are present in Drosophila, because you have all this genetic power in Drosophila, because you have the full sequence, because you know it's easy to work with, you can actually take that disease gene, you can make a mutation for it in Drosophila, and you can then start studying the disease function in Drosophila, and then once you have some idea of what it does, you can go on and look at it in humans, okay? So that is the kind of work that our lab does, okay? And I'll get to that in a bit, and I'll get to some of the points in that in a bit. So, one of the most important Nobel Prizes that came out was the discovery of innate immunity, okay? Innate immunity is the way by which your body responds without making antibodies, okay? And this is something that is present in all organisms, all animals actually, okay? This process. And this process was again discovered by three people, of which one of them worked on flies, okay? And this is Jules Hoffman. So that's the second Nobel Prize that the Drosophila got, yeah? And these are two people, the other two people worked on a mammalian model. I think they worked on mouse and Jules Hoffman. And so again, what was found was that the genes that Jules Hoffman had discovered in Drosophila, which were involved in immunity, innate immunity, and you can understand that that's really important in the context of a lot of infectious situations, in the context of things like allergies and things. So the same genes were discovered by these people in these in higher organisms. And so the molecular basis of it was actually worked out in all of these together. Okay, so now, as I had promised, I will start talking about the brain. Okay, and here I have to introduce to you some more people. So, when DNA was discovered by Watson and Crick, you know, a lot of people started studying using DNA. They started understanding how DNA functions in terms of affecting again the traits, as he said. And they were studying this in bacteria and in fungi, where it was easy to do all these experiments, right? And a lot of work was done in that context. And both these people, I'll introduce you up there, that's Seymour Benzer, and this is Ubaid Siddiqui. Both these people worked on these little bacteria and fungi and did this kind of work. And then at some point, when it became clear that DNA and genetics is really something that can be studied and one can move it forward, Benzer had the idea that he would actually use DNA, these methods that have been used in bacteria and in fungi, to actually study something more complex. Now, as I told you, Drosophila has been studied for so many years. It was being studied for its developmental plan and all of these things, all kinds of mutations, the fact that the eyes can be a different color, all kinds of things. So what Benzer thought was that, why can't we use Drosophila to study behavior? Yeah. Now, this was sacrilegious at that point. People didn't even believe that flies have behavior, okay? Would you think that flies have behavior? What kind of behavior do you think a fly would have?
They would have just fixed action patterns, right? Nothing very complex.
That's what you would think, right? Yeah. What about you?
It has mating behavior, courtship.
Right.
How it searches for food.
Right. So that is not what you are saying, right? What she's saying is a little bit different from what you're saying.
Because, everything can be reduced to fixed action patterns.
But do you think searching for food would be a fixed action pattern? It's more complex, right? Because you don't know where the food is, right? So you have to find it. Yeah. So it can't only be a fixed action pattern. Some of it can be, but not everything can be, right? So in fact, that's what one of the points that I would like to try and get across to all of you is that it's not just about fixed action patterns. I mean, the brain is there, and behavior can be pretty complex. And I don't have the video running here, so I can't show it to you, but I'm going to just give you this thing, and I'll ask you all to Google on your computers later, and actually look, if you're really interested, look up and see the different kinds of behavior that Drosophila has. Okay, it has so many different types of behavior. I'll give you some of the names, okay, and you'll get an idea. Anyway, so Benzer had this idea that he was going to start study behavior in fruit flies. And as I said, people laughed at that time. People laughed, and there were very few people who were agreed to do that. And so he had these few people who went and worked in his lab who sort of agreed with the idea that, yes, this was a good idea to try it out. And one of the people is Ubaid Siddiqui, who also worked as a postdoc in Benzer's lab in Caltech. This was in California. And Ubaid Siddiqui is the founder of our institute, okay? So NCBS was founded by Ubaid Siddiqui, and he is the person who brought the idea of studying Drosophila behavior into India. Okay, so Drosophila was being studied in India. I'm not saying Drosophila was not being studied, but it was being studied in the context of development, or in the context of what I showed you, the salivary gland chromosomes and trying to understand what they do. But the idea that you would study behavior in Drosophila was something that he brought to this. And so all of us who study behavior actually have had something to do with him at some point, or if not him, definitely Benzer, because everybody who works in Drosophila behavior has some connect with this. And so there's something called a tree that is, what's it called, Richard? That tree that Siddhartha made, remember?
Neuro tree.
Yeah, there's something called a neuro tree. And that is actually something that if you, it's like a family tree basically. You start with somebody, so Benzer would probably, for flies, it would start from Benzer, and then you connect people to that, right? So everybody is connected to everybody in that sense. Okay, the field has really grown since he started. I think when Benza started, probably there were his lab and, you know, about six people working in it. So the person whose face you unfortunately can't see very well, who's hidden up there, yeah, that is a gentleman called Ron Konofka. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about what he did and, you know, why is it important. Yeah.
So
this is the only thing I could get, unfortunately. So these are two fruit flies fighting. Okay, this is an aggression video. And this is what I said, Rana, you said that, you know, it's not just that. Okay, so this kind of videos, you will see many on the YouTube. If you just Google for it, you'll see that. So the kind of behaviors that have been studied in fruit flies are aggression, addiction, learning and memory, courtship, as you mentioned, yeah. So there are many different kinds of behaviors that have been studied. And as I said, if you're really interested in this, just Google and you will find all of these, you know, videos for all of these that are there. I'm not going to go into them because I wasn't able to actually get the videos down. But in any case, we don't work directly on this. I want to get a little bit to what we work on in the lab as well. Yeah. Okay, so I told you about Ron Konofka. Yeah. So Ron Konofka worked in Simo Benza's lab. And one of the things they got interested in was to try and find the most sort of basic behavior that there is, okay? And one of the things that all organisms respond to is the day and night, right? Because it's there, it's a natural cycle, and it's something that everybody responds to. And
this is not just human beings,
you know, just about everybody. So as you can see, there are some organisms that are active in the night, there are some that are active in the day. And this is a very inherent kind of behavior, which is called circadian behavior. Yeah, and it's very well understood. In the terms of the behavior part of it, is very well understood. And so what Benza and Konofka thought was that if this is really true, that we can study behavior using the fruit fly, then one should be, and getting genes that affect behavior, then we should be able to get mutants. That is, if you remove the gene for a particular kind of a function, then you should be able to see genes, see the behavior going away or changing, right? And the behavior that they looked for was this circadian behavior, because it's such a strong, robust behavior that they started looking for this. And so this is what Konofka did. He's the one who generated the very first mutation that created a fly, a fruit fly, which used to either it had no response to the day and light, okay? It couldn't tell the difference, so it was sort of active either during the day or during the night. Either way, it was completely random, or it had, you know, longer rhythms, as they were called. And so Konofka was the one who first generated this mutation, and then for whatever reason, Konofka dropped out of science, and these mutations were just around. But what is nice is that many, many years later, in 2017, this particular behavior of circadian function, it was worked on for a very long time by certain labs, and I'll come to that in a minute. But in these labs, finally, this also won the Nobel Prize. Okay, I'm just going to show you this so that you understand how behavior is studied in one context at least. Okay. So there is the fruit fly sitting inside that little glass tube. And that little coin is there to give you an idea of what the scale is. Yeah. And so you put the little fruit fly in there, you've given it a little food at the other end. Yeah. You take this glass tube and you stick it into a sort of a plate. You stick it in there where there's a single beam of light. Now, if this fly is active, yeah, you're not letting it fly, unfortunately, okay? So its activity is being measured only by walking here, yeah? If this fly is active and it's awake and it's, you know, doing stuff, it'll keep moving up and down. And what they count is how many times does it move up and down during the course of the day. So what is really interesting, and I didn't bring that here, but I'm going to draw it for you.
Of how this happens is what
Next set of people got the Nobel Prize for, okay? And so this is Jeffrey Hall, okay? He's the one who took the mutation that I talked to you about, which was generated by Ron Konopka. He took it and he started working on the genetics of it. And this was in Brandeis University. And with him started working Michael Rosbach. So Michael Rosbach also came from the same background that I talked to you about earlier, which is he used to work on bacteria, on yeast, on small things like that, small organisms. He was doing a lot of DNA work and molecular biology, what we call molecular biology. And then he got, he used to actually play, I think, baseball or basketball or something with Jeff Hall, okay? And they started talking to each other, and Michael got interested. He got interested in this question, and he said, you know, why don't we just start looking at some of the actual basis of what is it that these flies is happening in these flies that are not able to, you know, sort of tell day and night properly. And so his lab started working on it as well. So in fact, he ran a lab in which he did both, you know, sort of working on microorganisms and flies. And so the two of them worked together. And then Michael Young worked with Rockefeller, and I'm not sure of the history of how he got into it, but he got interested in it as well. And so three of them then got this prize, this Nobel Prize, as I said, just 2 years ago for understanding how circadian rhythms are controlled. And again, very interestingly, the basis of circadian rhythms, whatever is there in flies, the exact same genes, the exact same way in which they function, functions in human beings as well, but again, the complexity is much more, okay? So the principles of it you can understand from fruit flies, but the details of it you actually have to then work in the organism that you're interested in, okay? So you can use that to just understand the basic part. Yeah. Does that make sense? Yeah? Okay, I just put that fly there. Yeah?
Can you just go back to the last slide?
Yeah.
Controlling the
circadian rhythms, yeah. Let me just read. Yeah, I'll just check. Yeah, that's what it is. Circadian. Yeah, I'm sorry, that's getting cut out, but if you moved it up, then the top was getting messed up, so we just left it like that. Yeah. Anyway, so I actually had the sort of fortunate experience of actually working in Michael's lab originally, and so the work that I'm going to now come and talk to you about a little bit, which is what goes on in my lab. So we don't work on any of these things that I've been talking about so far. Okay, we use some of the methods, of course, but I'm going to tell you a little bit about what we do, and that actually started in Michael's lab. So this was the very first paper that I published with Michael. This was very many years ago, in 1992. And I'm sure this seems like absolute gobbledygook to all of you, right? Well, most of you, yeah? Okay, so I'm gonna try and see if I can clear some of those ideas. So the key point here is this thing, what is written there, the inositol 1,4,5 trisphosphate, it's a receptor, okay? And receptors are, yeah? For short, we call it the IP3 receptor, so I'm gonna stay with that, yeah? And the point is, what is the IP3 receptor? So I'm going to try and explain a little bit to you about why we are so hung up on this particular molecule. Yeah? And so please stop me if you can't follow. Okay? And I'm going to do it on the blackboard. Yeah?
Signals from the brain, signals go to your toes and things like that, right? So they have on there what are called channels, right, present here. And these channels that are present here, they will bring in various chemicals into the cell. Yeah? One of the chemicals they bring in is calcium. And that's because calcium is something that can actually change the way that the cell responds. It can go back and affect other channels which are present here. It can act on things which are present inside the cell and change the properties. So calcium does a lot of things. And one of the reasons that cells use calcium is because when cells evolve, and this is actually, so neurons use it by bringing it in like this. But other cells in which there are no channels which bring in calcium, or at least not in this mechanism, they essentially keep, when they have calcium, too much calcium around them, then they put them into what are called stores. They put calcium in here and they keep it in here. Now it's important to keep calcium away from places that,
just floating around, because calcium acts on the in the currency which is of, you know, for energy in your cell, which is ATP, right? Adenosine triphosphate. What happens is if calcium and phosphate react, they form the equivalent of what is there in your bones, okay? Which is calcium phosphate, which is the precipitate. And you can't have that in your cells happening. If that happens in your cells, then you've lost your energy and your cell is going to die. It can't be allowed. So you have to have ways by which you control this calcium in the cell. And the reason that calcium, I think, got used a lot, because when cells evolved very early on in the seawater, there was a lot of calcium around at that time. Okay, so they had to think of ways by which they could evolve and yet not, and evolve ATP and yet not have ATP and calcium react with each other and become a mess, right? So there are ways by which cells have evolved and managed to figure out how to do these things. And so this is something that is there, and this is something that exists in neurons.
So you have ways by which calcium comes in and you have this. Now this gene that I'm talking to you about, IP3 receptor, or this molecule, is present here. And what it does is it brings out calcium in response to something that happens outside. So it's a different way of bringing calcium into the cell. And the question that
we got interested in answering was that, okay, so neurons bring in calcium from here, from outside, and those are actually studied by many people, and everybody sort of understands a lot about how this calcium works in neurons. The question that we got interested in was that, okay, what does this store and what does this store-mediated calcium do in neurons? Does it actually have a function at all? Does it do anything at all there? Or is it just there for some reason or the other? You know, just because all other cells have it, is it there? So that was the question that we used Drosophila as a way to answer this, because as I said, this genes we had found in Drosophila, and so the other advantage of Drosophila is it has only single genes for these things. For example, the IP3 receptor is also present in humans, but in humans there are three genes for it. So that becomes a little harder to study, as you can imagine, to ask the kind of question that we were interested in asking. So we decided that it would be nice to try and answer this in Drosophila. And so the first thing we did was to, as we do in Drosophila, which is using genetics, is to make mutations in this. Yeah? And I'm going to show you now what these mutations did. Okay. So on the left is a normal fly. On the right is a mutant. And what we've done is we've stuck them from their heads. Yeah. And we've given it a very gentle air puff. And when you do that, what happens is that So I want you to appreciate what these flies are doing, right? So on the left is a fly, which is a normal fly, which is flying very nicely, right? And you will agree that it's flying nicely. On the right is this IP3 receptor, which has been, the IP3 receptor is not functioning properly. And as you can see, it's having serious problems in flying, right? It's not being able to fly. What I want you to notice is that it's being able to move its legs and things fine. So it's not that it can't move anything, but it's not able to move its wings properly. And so this is the kind of question that we've got interested in, is to try and understand what is it why is it that the IP3 receptor is affecting flight in Drosophila? And I think this is important because, as we discussed earlier, that flight is something that the fly will use for a lot of important aspects of its life. And so we need to understand what's going on there. So what we do is we, actually these are three different types of flies. You can see that's the mutant there. That's the normal one. But there are often flies that don't fly for very long. So there are some flies that can fly, they can fly for a long time, there are some that can fly for a short time. And we actually spend a lot of our time, and you can ask the people in my lab, we spend a lot of time actually sitting and looking at flies and figuring out how long they fly. Okay? And you might think that's very boring, but you can ask them what they think about it. Okay? So that is part of the work that goes on, and we try and understand. So what we're really interested in figuring out is what's going on in the brain of this fly that is making it stop. Because it's not that it can't fly, right? The middle one, it can fly, yeah? But it stops flying. And why did it stop flying? Yeah? What's the reason? And again, I don't think you can call it there's something that's going on in the brain which is stopping it from flying, right? And so that's the kind of question that we've got interested in trying to understand is what goes on. Why did it stop flying?
Is the IP receptor related to ATP dependence?
In a sense it is, yes. In a sense it is, yeah. Because IP3 receptor, the calcium that comes out from the calcium, from the IP3 receptor, some of it goes into the mitochondria. Now the mitochondria are the place where ATP is made. And this calcium that goes into the mitochondria can be used for, it can be important for generating ATP. So that's actually a very good question, but we don't know the answer to that. Okay, that's something that we're still trying to understand, in fact.
Because I had a doubt, like if the fly is not able to fly very well, maybe because it's not getting enough energy to it.
Absolutely, so absolutely, absolutely. But usually, So there's energy in two ways, okay? So you could have energy that is not enough of it in the muscles, yeah? And that's one possibility. What we found in these flies was that, so there are ways in Drosophila by which you can have a fly that doesn't fly well, and then in that fly you have a mutation which causes that, and then in that fly you can put back the molecule into specific types of cells, okay? So if you, in these flies now, if you put the IP3 receptor back in the muscles where the energy is primarily required, right, you don't find that the flies fly any better, okay? But you put it back in neurons, yeah, they fly better.
That's what I was thinking, because it's more like a neurotransmitter rather than an energy.
Well, it could be both actually, okay? So in fact, those are questions that are still there and we haven't actually answered them yet. Yeah, we're still trying to get to some of those questions, answers.
One more question, ma'am.
Yeah.
Not quite completed, but generally neurotransmitter have reuptake mechanism, right? Why isn't calcium getting stored rather than?
Why is it?
Why isn't calcium being reabsorbed rather than getting stored actually? For example, any neurotransmitter is not.
So I'll tell you the concentration of calcium. The calcium concentration outside the cell is in the millimolar range. Okay. And in the cytosol, in the cytoplasm, you don't want it to be more than about a few nanomolar, okay? So the difference, the gradient is huge. And so you can't really just throw it out. If you were doing that, then that's all the cell would do. It would just be throwing out calcium all the time. So this is probably a slightly more efficient way of doing it, is to put it into the cell and keep it inside there, yeah? In a form. Okay, I'm going to now show you a movie which is a free flight movie in which you actually see a fly approaching something, okay? And so this is something that I'm sure all of you are familiar with in your house, which is that you leave a piece of slightly overripe fruit lying around, yeah? And sure enough, these fruit flies will be buzzing around it, right? They'll arrive from somewhere. And this is what is would be happening in nature, and that is what actually we measure in the lab, yeah? So this is work that we've done in collaboration with another group in NCBS, Sanjay Sanya's lab, where they have these really nice cameras which can, this thing in, which can focus in, and what you have in the middle there is the equivalent of a strawberry, which is actually a nice odor, okay? So it's a nice odor, and that's what the fly, you release the fly there, and the fly will fly and come and actually land on that. Yeah, it will find it. Yeah. And so the idea is to try and understand how this happens and what is it that makes a fly reach there. What? Yeah.
When we allow the fly to go to group, do you actually let light be there or is there?
Even light. You have to have even light. Yeah. So you don't want any other distractions for the fly, right? You don't want to dark and light because then it'll, you know, those other stimulus will be there as well. So you want to make everything else as equal as possible, and then you just have the odor, and you actually have to make the fly a little hungry as well. So you have to starve it for a bit, and then it really responds. It, you know, it sees the, it smells this food, and it sort of makes this trajectory and reaches there. Yeah. So fruit flies actually use flight for a lot of things, okay? So one of the things they use it for is, of course, searching for food, which I just talked about. They also use it for finding mates. So the female fly will release some kind of a pheromone, and then the male fly will sense that and will come, right? So they have to use it for that as well. And then they also need it for finding places where they can lay their eggs, because each kind of fly will want to lay its egg in the kind of environment that it has evolved to do it, okay? So fruit flies will, for example, always want to do it, lay their eggs in areas where their larvae will do well, and those are slightly overripe fruits, right? So that also they have to be able to sense, yeah? Where is this a good place where I can be? So they really do need to do this, and this can actually be quite a challenge because it can require flying for very long periods of time, right? So you can't just fly for a short time and reach there. You need to fly for very long periods, sometimes definitely minutes, and in some cases it might even be hours, because you know there's a gust of wind and the fly gets blown away far away from somewhere. Then to come back or to find it would be hard. So you can imagine that flies actually do need to fly for very long periods of time. And so one of the things that we realized was that if this is the case, and if they need to, you know, find places where they need to reach to actually, then they have to use their brain in somewhat more complex ways than one has thought from what you said, right? They need to actually integrate this information. They need to see, and they need to get the odors, and then they need to know when they're flying, you know, that when they're flying in this direction and the odor is coming from there, then they need to move this way. If they move this way by mistake, then they have to know that, okay, I've moved away from the odor, I have to come back. So all of this needs to happen. These are real-time decisions that the fly has to take, right? It has to take it from the brain. And so that is going to be important. And so the brain is going to really need to be able to do a lot of this. And the reason I'm telling you all this is because in a very simplistic way, when we started working with flight, yeah, when we first got these mutants, our first this thing was that it could be muscles, just like you said, right? And we found it wasn't muscles, okay? Then we thought, okay, maybe these flies just can't sense things, right? They can't sense the sensory. So maybe they can't see, and that's why they're not flying. That wasn't the case. Maybe they can't smell, and that's why they can't fly. That wasn't the case. Then we thought, okay, maybe it's the neurons that, you know, move the wings, you know? Maybe those neurons are not functioning. That wasn't the case either, okay? So we tested all of this and we found it was none of those. And what we found was that it was actually a set of neurons which were present in the brain, okay? And so that's how we realized that actually the whole process of flight is really complex and requires a lot of functioning in the brain and is actually drives, you know, what the fly will do for, you know, whether it will fly for a long time or a short time. And how does this happen? So I'm going to try and Now try and explain to you how this brain function is affected. And this was supposed to be a movie that we had made. It's a video abstract that we had made for a presentation. But unfortunately, the sound on that is not working. So I'm going to try and do it by explaining. And I think it's a little bit technical. So if you feel that I'm, you know, losing you, or if you're not comfortable with it, just stop me, okay? And I'll answer whatever it is. Yeah, I'll try and simplify it as much as possible. So here is what the full fruit fly brain looks like, okay, which I showed you earlier as well, yeah? And you can mark specific neurons in it. And this is really important because this is how we work out what's going on in the brain. There are tools by which you can mark specific neurons. Down below is the region which would be sort of considered the equivalent of the spinal cord, yeah? It's the ventral ganglion, what we call. That is what drives the neurons that actually drive wing movement or leg movement are present down there, yeah? and that's the central brain, that region up there. Yeah. So, okay. So here you are. So this is what we. So you can see that there are lots of different different kinds of flies. This is where Drosophila lies. And flight in Drosophila is what we were interested in looking at. And so, flight is used, as I mentioned to you earlier, for looking for food sources, for courtship, finding mating partners, for egg laying, all of these things. And the cues that I mentioned to you, again, I said this to you earlier, there are visual cues, there are olfactory means the smell cues. And mechanosensory means the where the wind is coming from, for example. Okay, so they always fly upwind. Yeah, so that is very important. And the way we look at this is by actually studying how which neurons are activated. So the way we look at how neurons are activated is by actually looking at calcium signals, and that was what was shown in the previous one. Okay. So what Steffi, who is unfortunately not here, she's away from the lab at the moment. What she discovered was that there were a set of neurons that are present down there in the brain. Yeah. And these make something called octopamine, which is the equivalent of norepinephrine. And they connect to a set of neurons which make dopamine. Dopamine is a neurotransmitter which is present up in the brain. And these dopamine neurons, what she showed was that they are actually active when the fly is flying. Okay. So she did an experiment and she showed that they are active. And the point was that if they're active, what are they doing exactly? And if you prevent activity in them, what she found was that the fly doesn't fly for very long. Okay, so the duration of flight becomes much reduced if those neurons are not activated. So these neurons project to this region called what is called the mushroom body, okay, which is present in the brain. It's like a higher brain center. There's something in the brain which is involved in learning and memory. It's there in humans as well. It's called the hippocampus. Yeah, and the mushroom body is something like that. So what she found was that these dopaminergic neurons project to some part of the mushroom body, and that region of the mushroom body that they project to makes a neurotransmitter or releases a neurotransmitter which is called GABA. Okay. Now GABA is a neurotransmitter which actually prevents neurons from acting. Yeah? It actually stops neurons from acting. And so this was really something which was very puzzling, because here was a set of neurons that are required for activity. When they are active, they are actually driving a set of neurons which are going to inhibit activity, right? They're going to inhibit activity. So what is going on? How come that is happening? What Steffi showed was that when those neurons are active, the dopaminergic neurons, these GABA neurons actually become inactive. So you have the equivalent of two minuses, right? So GABA neurons cause inhibition. And what you have is a set of dopaminergic neurons which prevents the GABA neurons from acting. Yeah? So you've got two negatives which then make a positive, which leads to the fact that you fly for longer. Okay? So this is how we sort of figured that this set of neurons, why they drive longer flight durations. Yeah? And what this told us was very interesting, that you know what we mentioned earlier, that flight is really energy consuming. You mentioned that, right? And so a fruit fly, after all, is not going to want to use up all that energy all the time. So its basal state is that it wants to keep itself at rest. And so all the time it's making this GABA, and it's telling its circuits that you stay at rest and you don't fly. It's only when it's stimulated, and probably those stimuli come from those octopamine neurons, and there is evidence to suggest that those octopamine neurons are activated by food, for example. Okay, so the idea is that those octopamine neurons then talk, and then this whole circuit is set up, and so that allows the fly to fly for longer. Yeah, and that is something that you know we sort of discovered earlier this year, and this was the work that was published. I would also like to mention that a lot of these kind of stories that come out require a lot of collaboration. So I told you, Sanjay is one of the persons who works in NCBS. So that nice flight video that I showed you was from his lab, because his lab is set up. Then a lot of the other behavior work that we did in this paper, which I didn't talk about, was done with the help of a French collaborator, Jean-Francois Ferber. So a lot of science actually gets done by talking to people, collaborating, being very open about your research, you know, not sort of hiding it and saying, no, this is mine, I don't want to show it to anybody else. That's the worst way to do science, okay? So, best is to, you know, put your data out there, talk about it to people, tell them what you found, they'll have some idea, you'll have an idea, talk to each other, and that's how science grows, actually, okay? Just, I think the same story would apply to what I told you earlier about Michael Rosbach and Jeff Hall, you know. They talked to each other in very informal ways, and, you know, it ended up with them getting a Nobel Prize. So, not everybody gets a Nobel Prize, I agree, but the progress of science is very much like that. And so, it's very, very important to be able to do that. And so, I think that's one take home I'd really like everybody to sort of understand, that science is something where a lot of talking to each other is required. And that's what a lot of us do. Yeah, we spend a lot of time. A lot of us go to meetings. We put up our work. All the students, you know, go up and talk. You know, put up their work there. And so that's what happens. Okay. So in the last few minutes, I will just I'll skip this and I'll just talk to you a little bit about. This is all, you know, really interesting, and we, you know, really enjoy working with fruit flies. All of us, we work on it, and we, you know, we do. I like to understand behavior, and so that's a very, you know, sort of something that a lot of the people in the lab really enjoy doing. But at some point we also thought that, you know, we're working on a gene, the IP3 receptor, and it was actually, I'll tell you how the IP3 receptor was discovered, okay? So the IP3 receptor was discovered as a protein which was present in the brain of all vertebrates, actually, in a region which is called the cerebellum. And that is what is shown there in that circle, okay? So that's a human brain, yeah? That's an MRI of a human head. And that region that is circled there is the cerebellum, yeah? And so, the IP3 receptor is very, very strongly expressed in the cerebellum, yeah? And the cerebellum is the region which is actually required for motor coordination, okay? It's required for actually helping you to be able to, you know, walk or run or all of those things. It's required for that part of the, it's required for other things as well, but that's one of the first things it was known to be required for. And so, you know, the point was that, okay, here we've got IP3 receptor mutant flies. They lose motor coordination. They're not able to fly very well. The IP3 receptor is present in Purkinje neurons. And, you know, we get, we know that it's the cerebellum is required in motor coordination. So then maybe there's a link there. And so while we were working on this, interestingly, in about 2007, this is about, 12 years ago now, a paper came out saying that if human beings have mutations in the IP3 receptor, they lose motor coordination. Okay? So they get a disease which is called spinocerebellar ataxia. Okay. And spinocerebellar ataxia was already known, actually. It exists already it's a rare disease, but there are many conditions of spinocerebellar ataxia which are known. And all of them lead to neurodegeneration of the cerebellum. Yeah? So it's a late onset disease. If anybody has the misfortune of having this disease, this particular gene in them, then at a sort of post 40s of around the age of 50, you start losing motor coordination and the cerebellar neurons start degenerating, and it can lead to fairly severe conditions. In some cases it's not so strong, in some cases it is. Okay. So it turned out that a mutation in the IP3 receptor also caused the same disease. And so one of the things we really got interested then in trying to understand is that what is happening in these Purkinje neurons that drives this kind of a disease, yeah? What does it do in these cells, yeah? Because I told you that it changes calcium levels, but we actually got interested in trying to figure out at the molecular level, you know, what is it in these cells that the IP3 receptor does? What does it change in these neurons? Why do they degenerate, right? So this is something that we're actively studying now. We're studying it in Drosophila. We're studying it in the mouse, and actually, Dania's here, there she is, yeah, so she's studying it in the mouse. So that's a section of the mouse brain, and those are Purkinje neurons that she has labeled really nicely in the mouse brain, which you can see there, yeah. And so we're trying to understand what's going on in these cells, and just to sort of give you an idea of what this disease looks like, I'm going to show you what happens, a video in what happens in spinocerebellar ataxia, okay. So, this is video that I actually obtained from this medical doctor. This is from abroad, as you can see. And this lady has this condition. She actually has not the IBC receptor, but a different kind of ataxia. But the conditions that the effect that it has on her is exactly the same as if you had a mutation in the IBC receptor, which is that she's not able to coordinate her movements very well at all, right? She has a serious problem in this. And so this is the human disease that we've got really interested in now, trying to understand what is going on. And I can answer questions about it, so what you know, but I thought, you know, I'll leave it at that. As I said, we're interested in understanding more the molecular basis of it. So I'll leave it at that and, you know, let you ask questions about what you think could be happening here.
Goal-directed behavior
we haven't done. Yeah, we haven't done that. So it's possible. So I think I should not leave you with the idea that the IPC receptor is only involved in motor coordination. It definitely does other things as well. But one has to study those. And so because we haven't studied them, I'm not going to answer too much about it. Okay? But it's very possible. For example, I do know. So Rishabh, who's worked in Michael's lab, in Michael Rosbach's lab, has shown that the IPC receptor also does, or not the IPC receptor, but aspects of calcium which are present through the IPC receptor that do affect circadian function, for example. So it's not, I don't think one can say that it affects only motor coordination. The reason we got interested in motor coordination is in part really because we think that it's something that's going to help us understand the spinocerebellar ataxia. I should also mention that spinocerebellar ataxia at the moment has no cure. So if somebody has this disease, has this genetic disorder, then there is nothing that can be done for them. Okay? Apart from just, you know, physiotherapy and stuff like that, there's really nothing that can be done. So it really does give us an opportunity to try and work on something that perhaps we can take and understand better.
And if it's a genetic disorder, how often is it transmitted to the next generation?
So most of the time, it's a dominant. So which means that if a parent has it in one copy, then any child that gets it in one copy will have that disorder then.